Welcome back to OGLDEV. Today, I'd like to introduce you to a very important type of object in OpenGL, one which will become especially useful to us when we start loading complete models from files, and that is the Vertex Array Object. The basic idea behind this concept is to encapsulate all the objects that are involved in getting vertices into the GPU in a single object. When you think about it, getting all the vertices into the GPU and having the GPU correctly parse the vertex buffer involves quite a lot of objects and changes to the OpenGL state. We have one or more vertex buffers. So far, we've only used a single vertex buffer, but in the future, we will see how to use multiple vertex buffers simultaneously. We have an optional index buffer. We also need to define the buffer layout using GL vertex array pointer. And finally, we need to enable the vertex attributes that we plan to use by calling GL enable vertex array array. Now let's imagine that we have a full-blown game with lots of meshes and using different shader programs. Some meshes are rendered using a shader program that uses two vertex attributes and some require five. With our current facilities, we will need to bind the correct buffers before each draw call, set up the layout and enable the corresponding attributes. This is quite a headache, not to mention that it is error-prone and requires a lot of GL calls. Therefore, the OpenGL spec introduced a type of object called Vertex Array Object, or VAO. The VAO is basically a thin meta object. It doesn't hold a lot of data on its own, like the vertex buffers do. Instead, it simply contains pointers to all the buffers that belong to it, quote-unquote. In addition, the VAO stores the layout and the list of enabled attributes. So whenever you bind a VAO, the OpenGL driver automatically binds all the relevant buffers, sets up the layout and enables the proper vertex attributes. If you have multiple meshes in your game, you can simply assign a VAO per mesh, and in order to switch between meshes, you just need to bind the corresponding VAO. That's most of the theory behind the Vertex Array object. Before we dive into the code, I want to mention another concept in OpenGL that I've only touched upon very briefly in the past, and that is the compatibility and core profiles. You see, over the years since the original publication of the specification in 1992, OpenGL has accumulated a lot of fixed function functionality, which we now consider deprecated. Modern OpenGL development is expected to use the programmable pipeline. In version 3.0, OpenGL has introduced a concept of compatibility and core profiles. The compatibility profile includes all the deprecated features, allowing you to use the old fixed function pipeline. The core profile is OpenGL without the deprecated features, and this is generally the recommended way of working with OpenGL. So what does it mean for vertex array objects? The spec tells us that when we use the compatibility profile, there is a default VAO under the hood that captures all the vertex-related stuff. This default VAO doesn't exist in the core profile, so we have to create a VAO in order to upload vertices in the GPU when using the core profile. Let's see what happens when we tell FreeGLUT to create a core profile in one of the previous tutorials that doesn't create a VAO. We do this by calling GLUT init context version with the major and minor versions of OpenGL in the first and second parameters, respectively. We also need to call GLUT init context profile with the GLUT call profile macro as a parameter. Make sure to place these two calls before creating the window, which also initializes the OpenGL context. As you can see, nothing is rendered. In this tutorial, we're going to create and use VAOs, so from now on, we will be able to use the core profile by default. This will help us keep the code modern, because deprecated features will simply not work. Now let's see how to combine VAOs into our code, and I'd like to start by reviewing a few changes that I've made in this tutorial, specifically moving most of the application code into a class. After all, this is a modern OpenGL with C++ course, so it's better that the code will indeed be based on C++. I assume that you are familiar with C++, so I'll just touch upon the key areas. Okay, so I've created a class called Tutorial 17. At this point, it doesn't inherit from any higher level framework class. We'll develop this as we move forward. We have a constructor, destructor, and an init method which returns a boolean for success or fail. We have four callback functions for handling FreeGLUT events such as keyboard, mouse, etc. Note that these cannot be called directly by the actual FreeGLUT callback functions because they are class members and FreeGLUT is a standard C API. Therefore, we register regular C functions in FreeGLUT, and in these functions, we redirect the calls to the class using the pointer to the tutorial 17 class that we have right here. The main function will allocate an object using this pointer. So these are just wrappers, and the actual functionality is inside the class. In the private section of the class, we have a few methods and all the variables that were previously in the global section, like the texture and the camera. We also have a few OpenGL handles here for the vertex and index buffer, and also for the VAO. There are two sets here, one for the cube and one for the pyramid, because we're going to allow the user to easily switch between them using the VAO. Notice that these variables are initialized to -1. I'll talk more about this when we get to the destructor. The constructor is very simple. We just initialize stuff like clear color, culling, and the perspective projection infrastructure. Let's keep the destructor to the end and focus on the init method. We have calls here to create the cube and the pyramid VAOs, so let's go there. Here we can see the usage of the VAO for the first time. We start by allocating a handle for the VAO, and by now you should be familiar with this pattern. The number of handles to allocate in the first parameter, and an address of an array in the second parameter. Naturally, the array must be big enough to store all the results. Generating the handle is not enough. We must bind it in order to make it active, so we call glBindVertexArray, passing in the handle that we've just created. Note that there is no target here as with buffers or textures. The target is simply embedded in the name of the function. From now on, everything that we do in this function will be recorded in that VAO. We continue same as before. We generate a vertex buffer, we upload the vertices into it, we enable the two vertex attributes, and we configure the layout for each attribute. One thing that is critical to note here is to place the call to glVertexArray pointer after glBindBuffer. The reason is that only when glVertexArray pointer is called, the driver checks which buffer is currently bound to the glArrayBuffer target and records this info in the VAO along with the vertex attribute info. So if the order was reversed, we would simply not know which buffer to use. After we finish with the vertices, we handle the indices, same as before. Before we exit the function, we clean up after ourselves, and this is very important because if you leave the VAO bound, it means that other parts of the code that call glVertexArray pointer will potentially trash it with incorrect info. So we have to disconnect our VAO by calling glBindVertexArray with 0. After that, we do the same with the vertex attributes and the two buffers. Below this function, we have almost the same code for creating the pyramid VAO, only the vertices and the indices are different. Don't worry about the code duplication. This will all be gone when we implement a proper mesh class for loading models from files. Now let's go back to the init function. You can see here that we bind the cube VAO as the default vertex array object. In this demo, the user can switch between the cube and the pyramid using the keyboard, but we want to have some default in case the user doesn't click anything. We continue by allocating the texture. Note that I moved the binding of the texture and updating the sampler uniform from the render loop to this function because it needs to be done only once. We initialize the camera and we are done with this function. Next comes the render loop, and you can see that it became simpler. We only need to update the WVP matrix in the shader and execute the draw call. Now, there is a small twist here. The cube has 36 vertices and the pyramid has only 12. How do we know how many vertices to draw? One simple solution is to use some flag to tell us which object to render, but I wanted to show you that you can also query the current VAO by calling glGetIntegerV using glVertexArrayBinding macro in the first parameter and an address of the result in the second parameter. Now you only need to compare the result to one of the VAOs in order to decide how many vertices to draw. Next we have the keyboard callback function where we bind the cube VAO if the user clicked on 1 and the pyramid if the user clicked on 2. There is no change in the two remaining callback functions. There is also no significant change in add shader and compile shaders. They simply became class members. Now let's go back to the destructor of this class. In the previous tutorials, I didn't release the resources that the OpenGL driver allocated for all the objects that we used. In a real application, it's probably better to deallocate your objects when you are done with them, especially if you have lots of objects that are temporary in the sense that they don't last until the end of the program. So here we call the corresponding deallocation function for each object type, GLDelete vertex arrays and GLDelete buffers. We initialized all the handles to be -1, but since they are all unsigned integers, it means that they were initialized to the maximum value of unsigned integer, or about 4 billion. Since the driver starts allocating at 0, you're not supposed to hit that value, so we can use it to make sure you deallocate only objects that have been allocated. You may notice that I didn't delete the shaders nor the shader program. That's because I plan to have a dedicated class for them which will take care of that. The only thing we have left is the changes in the main function. Here we can see the initialization of the core profile. We create the tutorial 17 class object, call its init function, and if everything went well, we continue to the glut main loop. Now let's run this. We can switch between the cube and the pyramid by clicking on 1 or 2. We can go back a bit and switch between them again, and as you can see, it remains consistent because the same shader with the same WVP matrix is simply applied to a different set of vertices. So with the help of the VAO, we can easily create a mesh class and start loading real model files from Blender and the other modeling tools. I could have made this demo a bit more interesting by using a different vertex layout for each VAO, for example, position and texture coordinates for one object and position and color for the other. This would have demonstrated how the VAO helps us switch between the two layouts. To make this work would also require two different sets of shaders, and I didn't want to make the code too complex, so I leave it to you as homework. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please hit that like button and subscribe. You can also support this channel at patreon.com/ogldev. Thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next tutorial.